Hello, this is Dr. Chad Rolland coming to you again with another installment on Nature's Doctors. We've gone through the acronym NewSTART, standing for nutrition, exercise, water, sunshine, temperance, fresh air, rest, and trust in God. And I'm going to show you a couple more books and talk to you about a few more of those components. The first book I'd like to introduce you to, as we're talking about some healthy lifestyle choices, would be Dr. Andrew Weil, 8 Weeks to Optimal Health. This is an interesting book that goes through, just like it says, 8 weeks, little exercises and projects that you can work on, trying to improve a whole variety of different things in your health and lifestyle, and takes you in the right direction. So I encourage you that's a good book to think about. Here's another book, Total Renewal by Frank Lipman. And this too, I won't go through each of the index points, but it covers, similar to Nature's Seven Doctors, but it covers a number of different parts of your lifestyle and healthy living. And one last book by Eric Plasker, The 100-Year Lifestyle. Again, it's another book saying, let's take a look at all aspects of your life and not just what are you eating or not just are you exercising, and how can you take that and turn it into a healthy 100 years. The topics we'll talk about today would be on the list of Nature's Doctors. And the first one we'll talk about is sleep. Now, a lot of healing happens while we sleep. And if you're like me, it's sometimes easy to shortchange sleep and just work on other projects or continue to do different things around the house and just not think about it as an important component of health. But it is something that we want to emphasize in getting that 7.5 to 9 hours regularly, taking naps if I'm tired, for example, if I'm facing an illness or I've been through a stressful experience. Now, here's a few tips for sleep. One, have a regular place that's comfortable and relaxed for sleeping. Have a regular time that you sleep. Keep in mind that our body goes through 90-minute cycles of sleep, where it goes through lighter sleep and deeper sleep. And actually, sleep scientists say that we wake up or almost wake up every 90 minutes. So if I add that up, going to a 6 or preferably 7.5 hour sleep period, or going even into 9 hours, would give you that 90-minute cycles. And when you wake up at the end of a 90-minute cycle, if you set your alarm and you time it with that, then it's supposed to make you feel not groggy when that alarm goes off, but you're supposed to feel more alive and invigorated and refreshed. Having a quiet place, either a low-level music initially for going to bed and maybe some reading, but no television and no screen time, because the blue light from the backlighting of the screens boosts the adrenaline and the serotonin in your brain, and that's actually telling your brain to stay awake instead of going to sleep. So it's much better that if you do wake up during the night, for example, and you can't go right back to sleep, to get up and go someplace quiet, the dim regular light, and do some reading, but not with a screen. Just a regular book until you're sleepy again, and then go back to bed. Keeping your brain understanding that when I'm in bed and I'm sleeping, this is what I'm doing here. And it will condition it so that you'll be able to sleep better and quicker. The average person does fall asleep within about 14 minutes, although it varies widely from shorter to longer period of time. Another tip is to use a white noise machine. Some people will run a fan or something in the background just for a little bit of cover-up noise, especially if you are in a neighborhood or someplace with automobile traffic that you don't have control over keeping in a quiet environment. Keeping the same routine before you're going to bed, as far as if you do a little reading and you're brushing your teeth and you're getting other things ready, your body sees that and knows that it is conditioned to see this is moving towards sleeping and this is the time I'm going to be sleeping. And so a routine is important. Not eating within 2 hours of going to bed. Digestion takes anywhere from 4 to 6 hours typically, and if you have acid reflux or other problems, plus as your body digests your food and it wants to open the valves of the stomach, it needs to roll over a little bit or toss and turn. So if you've had a heavy meal, you're going to toss and turn for hours as your body's digesting and releasing that food. Using essential oils can sometimes be helpful. Some relaxing oils, it does trigger your olfactory memory, which again can be conditioned to say, oh, when I smell lavender, or when I smell lang lang, or when I smell something that's relaxing, this is something that I want to use for sleep. Again, you might want to have just one that you reserve for sleep, so that you're not triggering that memory during the day. You want to shield your alarm clock light and street lights so that you don't get that light into your room. Total darkness, even though your eyes are closed, the light does pass through your eyelids, and your brain monitors that all night long. And having thorough darkness is a better way to produce more melatonin and give you a better, deeper night's sleep. Consider taking a bath or a shower right before going to bed if you have trouble getting to sleep, because that will help. I know it's counterintuitive, but it actually helps lower your body temperature, which is necessary, about 1 to 2 degrees as you go to sleep in order to move into that deep sleep. Consider doing some relaxing breathing. That definitely helps to release the stress and tension of the day. Also, journaling, prayer, those type of things allow you to set aside your stress or your worries and be able to move into your sleep time. Other supplements might be magnesium, chamomile tea, valerian supplements. Of course, some people do use melatonin. Hemp CBD oil is helpful for that. And homeopathic remedies like a Calms Forte or something can also be quite helpful. I do recommend that you look into Dr. Matthew Walker. I believe he's the University of Southern California. Matthew Walker is a scientist whose career is all about sleep, and he has some very good online videos where he's recommending sleep and explaining a lot of details about sleep that he can do much more at his level of expertise and in an hour than I can in a 5-minute video. So I encourage you to look up Dr. Matthew Walker and sleep. Now moving on to water. Being well hydrated with pure water helps your body work better. It thins the mucus, gives you energy, flushes toxins. Of course, typical water guidelines would be to drink about half of your body weight in ounces during the day. So if somebody weighed 150 pounds trying to get 75 ounces of water, it's not the same as using people who say, can I just have my coffee or my tea or my milk or my juice? That all has water in it. And while that's true, one of the doctors said, if you would rinse your dishes with it and put it back in the cupboard, then that would be fine. Of course, that's tongue-in-cheek saying you really need just regular plain water. And not that some of those other beverages, but of course some of them cause you to have a digestive event triggered. So it's not really allowing your body to be relaxed. It works like a diuretic even if it has caffeine in it and a stimulant. So that water right there is not going to be as healthy for your body. And especially if you're trying to sleep or you're trying to be in a period of fasting and not eating, you want to consider just having regular pure water. Consider well water or spring water as the better sources. Try to avoid chemicals like fluorine and chlorine that are in water. If possible, using one of those sources of well or spring water and perhaps a Berkey water filter, because that'll take out a lot of the contaminants while not removing the healthy natural minerals. I'll show you a book about water. There was a doctor that came out and said, your body's many cries for water. It's a very interesting book. He goes on to explain why he feels that many of our diseases and ailments in today's society are because of a lack of proper hydration. Here's another book about water. Some of you may be familiar with the Bragg's amino acids or apple cider vinegar, and there's a book that they have on water. And lastly, there's water therapy, and this kind of a bonus for this particular video that you can look up historical hydrotherapy methods, which is ways to boost your family's health just using hot and cold water, ice packs, heat packs, different wraps, and they can help respiratory ailments, they can provide fever treatments, sometimes you can treat ankles, or you can even treat headaches by using pails or bowls of hot water, ice water, and towels to wrap. I can give you more details about that if you contact me. There's not enough time in this video, but you can also look up books. Here's a video that I have about using hydrotherapy techniques at home. They're free, they take some time, a little bit of education and some effort, but they can be very effective, especially in a case of some type of health crisis where you don't have either the money or the access to go get the medical care that you want, and they can provide some really helpful things for your body. Now, two more little things I'm going to throw in here. One is about the use of cold. Cold can be used to strengthen your own cells. Mitochondria in the cells are the energy producer, and there are such things called cold shock proteins. And by taking cold showers, you've seen some of these athletes now doing cold therapy, either in between their different performances or even afterwards in order to reduce inflammation in their body. And there really is something to that. And getting in a cold shower and just taking your regular shower and ending your shower with 1 minute of pure cold can be very helpful, not only invigorating, but it's actually energizing your body and reducing inflammation. Now, up here in the North Country where we live in northern Pennsylvania, and I know we're not in northern New England or in Montana or whatever where you guys have even colder weather, but our groundwater is plenty cold, I'll tell you that, to be able to take a nice, effective cold shower. The other thing to consider is that if you're taking a shower, some people like to do an alternating, so they would do a couple minutes of cold, and then a few minutes of very hot, and then a couple minutes of cold again. Again, if you have diabetes or some sensitivity or heart condition, you need to be careful of that. Talk to your doctor about it. But cold therapy, within as little as 4 days, can begin to change your body and increase your energy production through your mitochondria. The other thing to talk about here in conclusion would be heat. And we like saunas. Of course, in 2020, maybe the gyms are closed and we're not able to get into public saunas. Some European countries, many people have their own personal saunas, but you can also improvise something at home, even a hot bath or a hot shower, steam room. Just be careful, again, if you have any conditions that would be weak or sickness that would put stress on your system and would cause you to have other health problems. But heat shock proteins, even though they're less in older people, they're still there. They're more vigorous in younger people, but increased, one study showed they were increased by 50% after only 30 minutes in a 165-degree sauna, and that increase lasted for 48 hours. Why do you care, you would say? What is a heat shock protein? Well, one of them, called heat shock protein 70, increased by 50% per degree Celsius increase in body temperature, and it increased the effectiveness and the performance in the lung tissue. What does that do in the lung tissue? For example, it inhibits influenza A, viral activity and replication, and it activates innate immune cells like your dendritic and your natural killer cells. So having that heat shock protein benefit from the heat exposure in your body is another way that you can use a natural remedy to really strengthen your immune system and strengthen your body. Now, heat is not only shown to decrease infections and strengthen your body during that time, but actually decrease all-cause mortality. And there's numerous studies using a sauna therapy for about a half an hour, for as little as, the cooler the temperature, the longer the time has to be, but for as little as a few times a week, has been shown to decrease all-cause mortality in some studies by up to 40%, which is very significant. I'd like to refer you to a website called Found My Fitness by Dr. Rhonda Patrick. Dr. Rhonda Patrick has a number of different interviews with scientists, including Wim Hof the Iceman, and others of talking about sleep and about heat shock proteins, and she can really give you a lot of education and benefit as to why these can help in a natural way to help you improve your overall health. You don't have to do them all the time, but they're available. They just take a little time. They're free usually, and you just have to put the effort in and the know-how to do that. This information, as you know, is accurate to the best of my knowledge, although I share personally what I do. This information is for educational purposes and is not medical advice. I'm not your doctor unless you contact me and want to work with our office through telemedicine for some of the nutritional or other lifestyle counseling that we do. You can reach us at rolandhealth.com. And until next time, this is Dr. Chad Roland wishing you the best of health and happiness.